Bless the name of the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless your holy name today. Bless the name of our God this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We praise you, Jesus. We praise you, Jesus. I wonder this morning, how many here today, you just have a need today, but you're trusting God with that need. There's a need that you Maybe it's in your life. Maybe it's somebody you care about deeply. But there's just a certain need, and you trust Jesus. He's able, the cornerstone, to touch that need. I want you to slip your hand up all over this room just as a sign of faith and surrender. Here it is, Lord. You know the details. You know everything about it, and I just trust you with it right here. Hallelujah. Amen. Just keep it raised for a moment. You know, sometimes we just need to stretch our faith a little bit and exercise our faith. And you say, well, Pastor, that's just a simple thing, just raising my hand. You know, sometimes we just have to surrender things to the Lord and say, here it is, Lord. And that's what I'm doing today. Here it is, Jesus. Hallelujah. Now, Father, as every hand is raised right now, we just pray for every one of these needs. Believe together today, God, for signs and for miracles and for healings and for breakthroughs and for jobs and for financial supply. And we pray for salvation. And we pray for baptism of the Holy Ghost. And we pray for restoration. And we pray, God, for blessing. And we pray for anointing. And we pray, God, for a future. And we pray for healing. And we pray for forgiveness. And we pray for grace. And we pray for mercy. And we just lift these things to you today, Father, knowing that by God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus our Lord. We declare unto you, Lord, that to you in your hearing this morning. We remind you of your word today, Father, that declares, I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor their seed begging for bread. We declare your word unto you this morning, Lord, as we declare we're more than overcomers. We are those that give us strength today, people that are overcomers by the blood of the Lamb and by the words of our testimony. We declare this word before your hearing today, Lord. I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. Now, Father, go and strengthen and heal and touch and set free. We declare your word this morning in Luke 4 that declares, Jesus, you said it of yourself, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me and hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, to give sight to the blind, Lord, to set the captive free, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. We just rehearse it in your hearing today, Lord, that you are the anointed one. You are Christ, the Son of the living God. And there's nothing in our life that is going on that you're not able to divinely intervene. And so we make intercession for those needs this morning, and we give you praise for it. Now come on, let's praise him for it, would you? Come on, let's praise him for it, church. Hallelujah. Thank you for touching. Thank you for healing. Thank you for restoring. Thank you for just sustaining us, Lord. It's by your grace we stand today. It's by your mercy we stand this morning. And we give you praise and we give you glory and we give you honor. Hallelujah. Amen. Now reach over and take that person next to you by the hand. And I want you to pray God's blessing in their life. Come on, pray God's best in their life right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray the best heaven can afford for their life. Bless their family. Bless their marriage. Bless their children. Bless their spouse. Bless their children's children. Bless their past. Bless their present. Bless their future. You are the cornerstone today, Jesus. Oh, we're dependent upon you this morning, Jesus. Do your work in the hearts and lives of your people today, we pray. Hallelujah. Amen. Sing it. Hallelujah. Is worthy of praise. Sometimes we do go through a trial. Sometimes we do go and face a mountain. But oh, aren't you glad you got the mountain mover holding your hand? Amen. You got the way maker going before you. Amen. Hallelujah. He's the one that goes before me, behind me, beside me, beneath me, around me. Bible says the angels of the Lord encamp around about those that love him and fear him. And I want you to know something, church. With Jesus down in your heart and life, you never have to go it alone. Hallelujah. He is your shield. He's your buckler. He's the strong tower of strength that we can run into. Hallelujah. And I feel his strength here today. Wow. Praise God. Glory to God. Today we're going to look at something out of 1 Samuel chapter 17. I don't know if they can put my game changer graphic up there at first here for me. We've been talking this month about game changer. And last week, as you recall, we were talking about whose side are you on. You know, that's an important question. If you're going to be a game changer, you better have the game changer on your side. And you better get on his side. Hello? Amen? Whose side are you on? And last week we talked about Joshua and how that Joshua met the captain of the Lord's host. And basically the Lord asked Joshua, he said, if you're going to win this battle against Jericho, you better decide if you're on my side or not. It's not if I'm for you or for your adversary. It's this, Joshua, are you on my side? And that's a real important question for us to keep asking ourselves when we think about being a game changer. You know, we're getting ready to enter the biggest basketball season of the year, the thing about the tournament. And by the way, I just want to say to all you Kentucky fans, hallelujah, congratulations, 31-0. Hello. I hate to see those guys go to the NBA. They'll all have to take a cut in pay. Hello. That was a bad joke. And what about those cards? Hey, man, all our adversity, but we got the win over the number two team in the country. I think they deserve a little love. Amen. Praise God. I never thought that number 12 would be the X factor for Louisville. Amen. He hit that game-winning shot. I've been working with that guy a long time. Hello. Not really. I've been fussing at number 12 all year long. I'll just be transparent about it. And somehow or another, he may. I think, well, actually, when they zoomed in on it, he shot that game-winning shot. Guess what? He had his eyes shut on that. Did y'all know that? He had his eyes shut. He went in. Praise God. Hey, God's good. And game changer today, you know, we know Jesus is the game changer. Last week, Joshua had a game-changing decision. He said, I'm going to be on the Lord's side. You know, the game changer is somebody that is a difference maker. Whether it's in sports or really the context, we've been talking about it as in spiritual matters. Jesus is the difference maker in my life. Jesus is the game changer in my life. In the day that I said I'm going to be on his side, that was a game-changing decision in my life. In the day in 1 Samuel 17, there's a game changer I want us to look at, and his name's David. Let's look at that verse now, Jeff. If you can put it up there for me, 1 Samuel chapter 17. And the Philistines stood on a mountain, and on the one side, and Israel stood on a mountain on the other side. And it says that there was a valley between them, verse 4, and there went out a champion out of the camp of the Philistines named Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. 6 cubits and a span. Today, that equates roughly somewhere around 10 feet tall. I want you to get a little picture of that. Here's a giant of a man, some 10 feet tall. How'd you like to have him playing center for your basketball team? Amen. That's a big tall guy. Verse 5 says, and he had a helmet of brass upon his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail, and the weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of brass. Some people translate that somewhere between 150, 200 pounds was just the weight of his coat of brass. He was a huge man, and he was a giant of a man. It said he had these things of brass upon his legs, and he had a target of brass between his shoulders. That was his shield. And the staff, get this, the staff on his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his spear's head weighed 600
shekels of iron, and one bearing a shield went forth. The head of his spear weighed 15 pounds in iron. And it says that he had someone that bared a shield. It was an armor bearer, and this guy went before him. So everywhere Goliath went, think about this. He had a guy with a shield in front of him who was always looking out for his best interest, and he was always going before him and seeing after him, and he was his armor bearer. So think about that. How would you like to have a guy like that in your life? Well, it says that he stood, verse 8, and he cried unto the armies of Israel, and he said to them, why are you come out to set your battle in array? Am not I a Philistine and your servants to Saul? Choose you a man for you and let him come down to me if he be able to fight with me. And the verse says, to fight with me and to kill me. Then will we be your servants, but if I prevail against him and kill him, then shall ye be our servants and serve us. And the Philistine said, I defy the armies of Israel this day. Give me a man that we may fight together. When Saul and Israel heard those words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and they were greatly afraid. Now, he's going to jump to verse 26 for me. I'm going to read just a few more verses here and then we'll move forward. Verse 26 says, David was speaking to some men that were standing by him, and they were questioning, what's going to be done to the man that killeth this Philistine? This was what David was asking. And they said to David, whoever takes away the reproach from Israel, or who is this circumcised Philistine, that he should defy the armies of the living God. And the people answered like this, saying, so shall it be done to the man that killeth him. And Eliab, his eldest brother, heard when he spake unto the man, and Eliab's anger was kindled against David. And he said, why did you come here? And from who did you leave in charge of the few sheep we had in the wilderness? I know your pride, David. I know the naughtiness of your heart. For you've come down that you might just see what's going on in the battle. And this is what David said, verse 29. And David said, what have I now done? Look at what he says. He says, is there not a cause? Can we say that together one time? Is there not a cause? Let's say that together. You ready? One, two, three. Is there not a cause? And he turned from him toward another and spake after the same manner. People answered him. And David rehearsed this to Saul, because they sent Saul after him. And David said to Saul, hey, Saul, King Saul, let no man's heart fail because of him. I'll go. Your servant will go, and I will fight this Philistine. I'll fight him. Give me a man that'll fight. You know, of all the Old Testament characters, David stands out, and he's listed in Hebrews, the Hall of Faith chapter, Hebrews 11. I believe he does stand out as one of the game changers of the Old Testament Bible. He was a game changer. You know, David's life is a little bit interesting. At the very beginning, he was born to Jesse in Bethlehem. By the way, the same town that Jesus was born in. And he was born to Jesse, a Bethlehemite. And the Bible says something very interesting the chapter previous to this. I just want to give this to you quickly. The Bible says, first of all, King Saul had been the anointed king of Israel. And he had not completely obeyed God. And he was going through a season in his life where he had lost the anointing of God. And he had disobeyed. And he'd been doing a lot of religious activity and making a lot of sacrifices. But his heart had drifted from God. God knew that. And God had begun to release him from his anointing. And one day God revealed that to the prophet Samuel and said, Samuel, quit crying, fill your horn with oil, and go out and find the next king for Israel. And so the Bible says that Samuel the prophet went on this little journey, and when he went on this little journey, he came to Jesse's house. The Lord directed him there, and Jesse had 8 sons, and he said, basically, Jesse, God's looking for the next king of Israel, and he sent me to you. How many sons do you have, Jesse? Of course, he had, like, I think, around 8 sons, and so you know, he's looking for a king. So what does Jesse do? The father says, well, first of all, let me give you the guy that I think is most qualified, and that's my oldest son. So he sends Eliab out there. And this is what happens. He sends Eliab out there, and he takes the horn of oil, and he pours it, but it won't pour. And there's something about Eliab. He's the strongest. He's the oldest. He's the best looking. But he wasn't God's man for the hour. And so he brings him Abinadab. And Abinadab, the oil would not flow on his brother Abinadab. And he brings another one. And he brings another one. He just repeats this pattern. And finally, you guys have heard this story, some of you. He gets down to where it seems as though there's no one there. The oil will flow upon their head. And finally, Samuel the prophet says to Jesse the Bethlehemite, he says, is this all the sons that you have? And he says, well, wait a minute. There's one more son. He's the little runt of the family. He's the little guy. He's the shepherd boy. And he's out there with the sheep right now. But Jesse says, but I know he's not the one you're looking for. And Samuel says, well, please bring him to me. And so he brings him to him. And sure enough, the one that nobody else would have thought was going to be the next king of Israel, Samuel lifted the horn of oil, and that day the oil flowed on the head of David. And he was anointed to be the king of Israel. You know, there's a really important verse in that story, and it says something like this. It says, while man looks on the outward appearance, hello, God judges the heart. And the Lord has sent me here to talk about game changer in this relationship right here. First of all, I just want to say this. I believe every one of us understand Jesus is our game changer. Can I hear an amen? And when you're a believer and Jesus is living in your life and you're walking with him, he's walking with you, and the power of the Holy Spirit is flowing in and out of our life and directing us, and he's our governor. Let me tell you something. There's a purpose for that, and that is that God wants to use every one of us as his game changer in this earth. In other words, he wants us to be a difference maker in this earth. He wants us to have a sphere of influence in the lives of others, not so that we can draw disciples unto ourselves, but so we can draw people to Jesus. Hallelujah. And say, Jesus is the game changer. Jesus said, if you will lift me up, I will draw all men unto me. And so if you're here today and you're a believer and you're saved and Jesus lives in your heart, the Lord has sent me with an urgent message here this morning. That message is this. God's called you to be a David. He's given you a mantle of David. He's given you a special anointing that he's given every believer. He's given you a gift that he's given to every believer. And that gift is this. He's calling us to be a witness and a light and a difference maker for those around us. Oh, if you believe that, somebody help me give God praise for that this morning. And so the oil wouldn't flow until it flowed over David. And isn't it ironic? You know, that's the way God is. God judges what's in our heart today. Sometimes we look and we judge a book by its cover, but that's not what God does. God knows what's down deep on the inside of us today, and he knows what's really the matters and the issues of our heart this morning. And that's why even King Saul was trying to appease God for disobeying him, and he was bringing sacrifices, and he was sacrificing animals on the altar, and he was having religious activity and doing things to get back into God's favor. And God one day looked at King Saul and said, listen, King Saul, this is great and this is fine what you're doing, but let me tell you what, I'm not interested in what you're doing on the outside. I'm interested on what's going on in the inside. Do you have a heart of obedience? Let me tell you something, King Saul, obedience is better than sacrifice. And that's exactly the way it is with every one of our lives today. God wants us to be people that have a heart for obedience today. Amen, Pastor. You see, sometimes we can go through all the surface stuff, but really, whether the oil flows or not has to do with what's flowing on the inside of here, out of the issues of my heart. And so how many is glad God does look on the inside and not just the outside today? Amen. Don't ever disqualify someone from being a game changer for God, because while everybody else off to the side as an outcast, they may be the very one God wants to pour out his spirit upon. They may be the game changer. And so with all of that as a backdrop, there's another instance, and I'll give you this quickly. King Saul, in his disobedience, the Bible says he was having torments in his mind, torments in his spirit. And he was miserable because, let me tell you what, when you're not fully obeying God, Holy Ghost conviction can make you miserable. Amen, Pastor. And he's miserable and he's being tormented. And so one thing led to another through a series of events. David was brought in as a harp player. Here's little David. Little David. He'd been playing his harp out in the starry nights of the Judean hills with him and the sheep, singing praise songs to God, worship songs. He's writing songs, writing poetry. We read it in the book of Psalm. He was just fixing his heart toward God. Was David a perfect guy? We know later in David's life, he had some issues of his heart he had to deal with. But he was a worshiper of God. And he was just doing that. And finally, they said, well, we know a guy skillful in the harp. Bring him to me, Saul says. And as David would play the harp in the palace, it would drive the evil spirits away from King Saul. Let me tell you something. The anointing is a game changer today. How many knows something that's anointed will accomplish what it's set out to do? I like singing, but there's nothing like anointed singing. Can I hear an amen? I like preaching, but there's nothing that replaces anointed preaching. I like a lot of things, but boy, when heaven's touched it and the hand of Jesus is on it and the oil is flowing, it's a difference maker. It's a game changer. And that's what David was. Now, mind you, he was anointed to be king over Israel, but he wasn't ready for the palace just yet. He was still out in the sheepfold. And that's really the challenge for us today. Sometimes the Lord shows us things about ourselves and destiny in our life. And sometimes he reveals the plans he has and his heart's for us. But our challenge is, until that time comes, are we willing to go back out in the sheep field and do the thing that God has asked us to put our hands to do? Everybody wants in the palace, and nobody really wants to be out in the fields. But if you're really going to be a difference maker, sometimes you got to be willing to spend some time out with the dirty sheep. Hello? Good preaching, Pastor. Thank you. And so, it's an interesting series of events that one day Israel's on this mountain, Philistines are on this mountain, and in this valley for 40 days, twice a day, 80 times, this 10-foot giant of a man comes down and bullies him his weight around, fully dressed with armor, has an armor bearer in front of him. And I can only imagine, in a horrific voice, shouts out over to God's people, na 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 na. Hello? He shouts out, you guys are scared of us. Give me a man. And you know what the Bible says? The Bible says every time he did that, all of Israel ran for the caves. They were chilled to their bones in fear. One day Jesse says, David, I want you to go up, and I want you to take some cheese and some bread and some corn. Check on your brothers. And when he gets there, he hears the giant. And he sees the man who's defying the God of the army of Israel. He hears his voice. He sees his frame. He feels the earth move beneath his feet. And he looks around. And I'm paraphrasing it today, but he looks around to anybody that would hear him. And he says, why won't anybody face this uncircumcised Philistine? Is there not a cause? You know what a game changer is today? A game changer is someone who is willing to champion a cause greater than themselves. That's what a game changer is.
It's sure.